Howdy and welcome to Burley United Methodist Church's worship service for the last Sunday of June in 2023. It has been my practice since whenever I was in charge of worship services that on the Sunday furthest away from Christmas, that the hymns that we would sing that day would be Christmas carols. So that is what we will be singing today. And so the first carol this morning is, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. The call to worship this morning comes from the 42nd Psalm, as well as Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia. I'll read the light print. I'll ask you to respond in the bold. Our souls are filled with longing, O God, for we are thirsty for your truth. Sometimes we feel so alone and forgotten. Even in a crowd, we feel abandoned. The good we have done seems to count for nothing, and the forces of evil seem to prevail. The standards we uphold seem to be failing, and we pursue high values without reward. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for we shall again praise God. Rejoice, for Christ lives in us. Please join me in the opening prayer. when we feel like no one cares. Show us the worth of our own lives and what we seek to do. When worship is flat and uninspiring, open our lips in songs of thanksgiving and attune our hearts to the music. Meet us in this hour to give us new perspective on life. Amen. Our next carol this morning is Angels We Have Heard on High. As we come to God in prayer, it is a time where we seek oneness, connection with God. That as we speak or as we listen, may we hear that still, quiet voice that the prophet Jeremiah wrote about. O God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of Moses and Sarah, Ruth, Naomi, and Esther, God of birth, who conceived creation, you have brought forth a people, holding them close like a mother. You have nurtured them, and today you have nurtured us with your wisdom. Your judgment has not been wanting when we have strayed.
You have caused Christ to come forth, conceived by your Spirit of reconciling love. He grew up with stature in accordance with your will, submissive to your commandments, vulnerable to the needs of others. He stooped down to lift the weak out of their depths of despair. His authority you gave to him, his destiny you designed, his death you determined on behalf of us all. We live with such hope because of your care. We inherit the promise of new life because of your compassion. With such a witness of your sustaining indulgence before us, help us to show sympathy to others. Send us forth to labor in the name of Jesus. Equip us with the tongues to proclaim to them your word. Give us keen minds to detect the causes of injustice and oppression. Make us resourceful in devising means to expose and to eliminate persecution, to love kindness, to do justice, and to walk humbly with you. Help us to stand in rapport with the downtrodden. We pray for the sick, for those who are shut in for whatever reason. Give us cheer to our voices as we greet them in the name of Christ. May our arms embrace them with your encompassing care. Open our hearts to their plight, as with your hands we seek to lift them as a sense of dignity, as we are able to lead them to the wholeness. We loud your benevolent support for all your children and thank you for the kindness by which you hear this prayer. And we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, who taught his disciples when they prayed to say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
In many jobs, boldness and courage are called upon on a continual basis. Teachers and administrators, parents, as well as first responders and our military personnel must have those traits just to get through the day. For me, living 10 miles from North Korea and their 1 million man army was life-altering. Boldness and courage was a way of life for everyone there, soldier and family member alike. And the people of Ukraine have had to have that for these last 17 months, for they have lived on the front lines. I also lived on the front lines in Iraq, but I signed up for that. But for the people of Ukraine, they are the ones who are bold and courageous. I was just following orders. One word that goes along with boldness and courage is the word metal, M-E-T-T-L-E. Metal is determination and tenacity, having the resolve to see something through, no retreating. We find what Simon Peter and John's metal is in Acts 4. To get noticed, you need to be in someone's eyes extraordinary and exceptional. You are not extraordinary nor exceptional if all you do is get up every morning, go to work. Everyone is supposed to do that. One's metal isn't needed, nor becomes necessary when one's job is easy. If I had volunteered to go to Iraq in 2003, that would have been exceptional and extraordinary. But I didn't volunteer. I was selected. While everyone else was home in February of 2003 fighting off frostbite in minus 30 degree weather in Fairbanks, Alaska, I was packing my bags for the desert and 100 degree plus days. I have gone to work serving the church for 40 years with metal because those whom I serve deserve it, because the Holy Spirit demands it. If you have metal, where did you get yours? Who mentored you? I think for me, it was my stepfather working long days and a lot of Saturdays to provide for his family and to keep his company afloat. Hard work. Digging ditches, pouring concrete, tying steel. Those are the things I learned in my teen years. How to do and how to do it well. And to do it to a standard, to pass the keen eye of a county building inspector. And here in Acts 4, the apostles, Peter and John, are facing their first big test. Jesus is long gone. He left the 11 disciples in chapter 1. Weeks after Jesus had been crucified, some of the same religious leaders want Simon and Peter to answer their questions. Inquiring minds want to know why they're still doing what they are doing, starting with Acts 4. While Simon Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came to them, much annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming that in Jesus there was the resurrection of the dead. They also arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. The religious authorities wanted to know, on whose authority are you performing these miracles? Of the five W's of who, what, where, when, and why. In the army, when you are exchanging gunfire with your enemy, why they are shooting at you is the least important. The answer of the other four questions are enough information to get you through the day. Simon and John are now detained and in protective custody. And I ask you to be them. I've been in jail 4 times and prison once. And even as a visitor, in my cases, you're in a common room with whomever you are visiting. 2 chairs, 1 table, 2 doors, no doorknobs. You are leaving that room when someone else decides when you leave that room. I place ourselves in the sandals of Simon Peter and John. We would, could, or should at least be nervous, knowing or worrying about what is going to be going on in the future, that we are going to be held accountable, isn't looking too good for us. The story continues. The next day, the rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were the high priestly family. When they made the prisoners stand in their midst, they were inquiring, by whose power? By what name do you do this? This group of learned men that was the Sanhedrin of 70 were the Supreme Court of their day. And the question for us, whether we are the spectators or if we are Simon Peter and John, will they have the mettle to stand up before the Sanhedrin? Or will they turn tail and run back to Galilee, never to be heard from again? Then Simon Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who is sick, and are asked of how this man has been healed, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you. He is in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that which you rejected by you, the builders, has become the cornerstone. This is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. And with that, Simon Peter drops the mic. Here in Acts 4, Luke is the court reporter. Now when the Sanhedrin saw the boldness of Simon Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. When they saw the man who had been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. Simon Peter and John have defense exhibit number one, the man that they healed with them. These 70 high, learned, well-schooled men were amazed, for standing before them were two unschooled, incredibly average Galileans who spoke with great wisdom and confidence. The Sanhedrin were amazed at the mettle of these two apostles. They received what they needed from Jesus. In the end, when the Sanhedrin could not deny the evidence standing before them, they were silent. They recognized the man who had been lame and who was no longer lame. And when Simon Peter and John were excused, the Sanhedrin deliberated. And they said, "What will we do with him? For it is obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. But to keep it from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone about this name." So they called Simon Peter and John in and ordered them not to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. Verse 16 reminds me of Captain Jim Lovell's line from the movie Apollo 13, Houston. "We have a problem. Jerusalem. We have a problem. We cannot refute what they did. How are we going to get out of this?" So they decide to place a gag order on John and Simon Peter. "Don't talk about this anymore." But the apostles would not, could not abide by what the Sanhedrin said. But Simon Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in God's sight to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot keep from speaking about what we have heard, what we have seen and heard." Their mettle shows here. Their courage and defiance is in their words. And after they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard that, they raised their voices together to God and say, "Sovereign God, who made the heaven and the earth, the sea and everything in them, it is you who, by the Holy Spirit, through our ancestor David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples imagine vain things? The king of earth took their stand, and the rulers have gathered together against the Lord, against his Messiah. For in the city, in fact, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look at their threats and grant to your servants to speak to your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. This was the first of many conflicts with the religious elite that the apostles came in contact with, and every time the apostles came out on top. What did they pray for? Did they pray that God would eliminate the threat? No, not in the least. They prayed that God would give them courage and boldness, the mettle, to stand up to those threats now and in the future. What was their secret? What was the source of their mettle, their boldness? None other than the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that enabled Peter to speak with boldness and with mettle. What is it like? How does it feel being filled with something? It might be like taking a bath and lowering yourself into the bathtub with the water coming up finally to your neck. Such an experience is comforting and soothing. I am not sure I would characterize the Holy Spirit as comforting and soothing. Usually, at least to me, the Holy Spirit takes the role of a taskmaster. The Holy Spirit is here to energize us, to make sure that we cannot fail, so that we can experience the joy beyond anything else. Paul writes to the Christians in Ephesus, "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most out of time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Spirit." That's how the Holy Spirit works. We must be attentive and prepared, anticipating it in our daily lives with Christ Jesus. As the old saying, the early bird does catch the worm, but guess what, the early bird? You have to get up. At dawn, you have to be ready. The worm will never show up in your nest. There is always work to be done to receive the reward. If to you a worm is a reward, so much power to you. Not so much to me. But to be ready for these future challenges, we must be prepared now. To be in prepare, to read God's word, to be in worship, and to commit to being in fellowship with one another. And if we do all that, leave the rest to the resurrected Jesus. Amen. Join me in prayer. Loving God, we come to you. Thank you that you have filled us up to the brim with the power and the love, the acceptance and the generosity of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, dear Lord, for this time together to be with one another. Send us out to do your bidding, to do what you call us to do this day and every day. Amen. Thank you. And our final Christmas carol this morning on the Sunday that's furthest away from Christmas is the great Austrian hymn, Silent Night, Holy Night. May God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit, fill you with all good things, providing for you today and forever. Amen.